Hello, how are you all doing? My name's Ken Weston. I am with Panther. I am the field CISO. Today I'm going to be talking about securing the supply chain. The idea here is how do we secure everything in our infrastructure from our code to cloud. It's interesting is I'm going to be talking about modern SIEM. I'm kind of curious, how many of you have a SIEM? How many love your SIEM? People are always, yeah, it's kind of a love-hate relationship. We love our SIEM when it actually works. Also, one of the challenges that a lot of folks have with SIEM, particularly when we're dealing with high volume data sources, is the actual cost that's associated with that. And a lot of that is because of the evolution of SIEM itself. So I'm going to be talking a little bit about some of the unique approaches that we actually take at Panther. I'm going to talk a little bit about the software supply kill chain. You guys are probably very familiar with kill chains. I'm going to talk about a little bit how this applies to the software side of things. It seems like when I was starting with SIEM, like 2015, I might be dating myself here, I was actually selling into IT departments. And those IT departments were usually running businesses that were selling widgets or services. Very rarely would I run into a company that was actually selling technology itself. So a lot of the SIEMs were really designed to protect the corporate domains and the corporate security environments. So what's really evolved and changed since then? We used to have networks that were on a perimeter when people actually went into an office. Do you guys remember that back in the day? Right? We actually went into an office and they had to secure that. It was really focused around securing workstations. But what's really happened is this massive migration to the cloud. Everyone now is a tech company, whether you like it or not. You're offering something in the cloud, whether even it's your website, you're offering some sort of service. So everyone at this point is now a tech company. We'll talk a little bit about some of the log types and things like that as well, some of the things that we want to look at in securing. I'll talk about what to monitor. One challenge I think a lot of people face in SIEM is what data do we actually bring into the environment? What data can we actually drop? And a lot of those trade-offs can actually decrease your visibility and actually put your organization at risk. I'll talk a little bit about Panther and how we're a little bit different than some of these sort of legacy SIEMs. We are a cloud-first SIEM. We are hosted in AWS. We actually leverage AWS Lambda for applying our real-time detections, and we use Snowflake as our security data lake. Then I'll talk about some of the benefits of Panther and our platform, and then some next steps. If you want to learn more about Panther, I teach a bunch of workshops, so I can also give you guys a demo over at our booth there, but let's kind of get started. So who's heard of Lapsus? Who heard about this particular attack group? Right? So this was a really interesting group, Lapsus. Microsoft refers to them as Dev537. What's really interesting about this is that this group wasn't leveraging anything like zero-day vulnerabilities. A lot of their attack vectors were actually sort of low-tech in a lot of respects, but it was incredibly devastating for a lot of organizations that were actually hit with this. The primary attack vector was actually for the leveraging identity, so targeting individuals' identities, whether it's MFA fatigue, but they also leverage some other techniques. When they actually get in some code repos, what they do? They were looking for secrets. They were looking for access tokens that allowed them to pivot into other applications, as well as get access to other code repos as well. I know you guys never seen this before, but sometimes people actually code admin credentials in some of their code. Never happens, right? Yeah. So that's where they were able to get all of this. And sometimes they'll even purchase those credentials. Or sometimes they're even looking for an insider who they'll actually give them money to actually give access to that environment. So they're really targeting a different group of people as well. They're looking for developers. They're looking for people to have deeper access to those code repos. If they can compromise that, there's very likely they're going to be able to get into cloud infrastructure because they're using credentials that are actually authorized. So how do we apply this to kill chains? It's actually not very different. It's just that nowadays, everyone is a software developer in some respects, whether it's deploying applications in the cloud or deploying other people's code in your cloud. Everyone is pretty much a developer at this point. So we can actually leverage the Lockheed Martin kill chain to apply this. We just have to look at how we actually have our adversaries doing our reconnaissance and how they're actually targeting us. So this is a kind of an example, kind of a loose example of sort of how the Lapsus type of attack will work. They're going to do the initial reconnaissance. They may actually go for look for leaked credentials, look for passwords from social media accounts. That's where they might start. If they get a legitimate username and password, and again, I know this never happens that someone uses the same password for Facebook that they're using for their code, right? This has actually occurred. but they may have multi-factor authentication enabled. But if you keep firing off that alert and you keep clicking on it, eventually they may just say, OK. Or they may do it on accident. Eventually, they're going to find a way in, or they'll find a way to actually disable MFA in some of these tools. I actually show how to do that in one of my workshops where I talk about purple teaming when I run offensive operations against an Okta account. So I'm doing that on June 20th. So if you want to learn more about that, visit our website at panther.com and sign up. It's a lot of fun. I teach you how to write detections in Python and then also how to attack infrastructure and also how to develop a hypothesis for new detections from your security data lake. So they may commit sort of brute force. And a lot of times when I look at some of these attacks, they can actually be automated in terms of how we mitigate the threat. It used to be that all the alerts would have to come to an analyst that would then look at eyes on glass, and they'd have to do some sort of activity. But nowadays, we can actually send an alert not just to the SIEM itself or to like a ticketing system. We can actually fire off additional scripts. We can send it to SOAR platforms. In our example, we actually have a Slack bot. So if it's around a particular user, and that user is he's in Anaheim, and then all of a sudden, 10 minutes later, he's logging in from Moscow, you can send them an alert saying, hey, did you log in to Moscow? And they say no. Then you can automate a process to reset passwords and block that particular attack. And this is becoming critically important. In order for us to mitigate today's threats, they're automated. A lot of times, these attacks are automated. We need to leverage automation on ourselves. So then also you can get into a situation where maybe someone has a compromised admin account. And this is where I might have more risk-based scoring associated with that particular threat. They get in. They may also be able to access and create an API token. I do this in my workshop. I show an example. I have admin credentials. I can go ahead and I can create admin tokens. That's going to help me establish persistence. And then remotely, I'm using that API token to create additional users, as well as escalate that user's privilege to an admin. I've now established persistence within that environment. Now I have access to an Okta account with admin access. I can access all of those applications that are in that environment. I can get access into the GitHub repo if I like. I can also pivot into cloud infrastructure. Now this is where things get really interesting. We need to be able to identify if someone does pivot into a cloud environment. For example, I used to work a lot with ransomware. And ransomware just doesn't appear in an environment. There has to be a number of systemic failures that have to occur before that actually happens. So if we can't identify the root cause, it's going to happen again. Also, if an attacker actually gets some of these keys, we saw this with the LastPass breach as well. They didn't finish the sort of cleanup. The attacker was able to actually move into a cloud environment. If you're not having, if you don't have logging and visibility into that environment, you're going to go, your trail's going to go cold. So you may remediate it within your system. You may wipe a laptop that was infected that you think you got it all. But that person actually got access into your cloud environment, and they're going to sit, and they're going to wait. They're going to monitor, and they're going to do additional damage as a result. So this is something to kind of think about. I sort of mapped out some of the MITRE attack techniques that would align with this. So if you want to learn more about this, again, I leverage this in my purple teaming workshop, where we actually run this particular attack. So this is very actually real. This is a common type of attack pattern that we actually are seeing in the wild. So thinking about what types of log types we want to do, of course, you know, GitHub's going to be helpful. It was interesting. I looked at some of the top data sources and detections we actually have, and GitHub was one of the top ones that were up there, which is very different from other SIEMs. A lot of other SIEMs aren't monitoring people's code repos. But because of the way that we operate and a lot of our customers, they're much more tech savvy. They're much more, again, tech focused. They have applications in the cloud. They're sort of securing that customer environment. That's where we really shine. Another key data source that we optimize is just custom log sources. We bring in a lot of custom application logs that people are bringing. It's very easy for you to develop a new schema and ingest that data into our environment. So when it comes to AWS, we want to be able to monitor multiple entities. We want to look at things at the account level. Again, look at all of the platform activity within our environment. We want to be able to look at our service-based logs as well. Again, what sort of resources are being used, our S3, monitoring server access, and then, of course, host-based. So that's where we actually look at things like maybe an EKS, looking at the endpoint. You get some logs from AWS and some of the other cloud providers. But you also maybe want to have a sensor deployed to some of those environments, leveraging things like CrowdStrike or SentinelOne and some of the cloud workload protections that they offer, who are also great partners of Panther. So what's the most important? I think this is always interesting, is people have to make these trade-offs, particularly when you're dealing with some of the more expensive legacy SIEMs. This is a common complaint that we hear all of the time. It is too dang expensive. Like, we love to bring this login. We would love to have that visibility. But that's going to bring my budget for my SIEM 10 times what it was before. And I don't feel like I'm getting 10 times the value. So as a result of that, a lot of times, they're not bringing those log sources in. A lot of times, what we're seeing, though, is people are bringing that data into Panther. We are specifically designed for high volume, high velocity log sources. We actually apply our detections in real time using AWS Lambda. We then store that data on the back end in Snowflake as our security data lake, which is very much more cost effective than some of the legacy data architectures that we've seen with some of these SIEMs. We actually also provide 1 year of data retention out of the box, which is sort of unheard of in the SIEM market. You're lucky if you get 90 days. But also think about all of the like CloudTrail, OS Query, Suricata. These are all really valuable log sources. But then you have to make that sort of trade-off. You know, are we getting false positives? How do we tune these particular alerts? What's the latency look like? If you have to wait for some of these legacy SIEMs for the data to be ingested, and then you're running a safe search maybe every 5-10 minutes, and then the alert maybe has to come to an analyst for them to analyze, they may get it to it in a couple of hours, maybe a couple of days, depending on the team. That's going to put your organization at much more risk, particularly when we're dealing with cloud threats, where things move at a much faster pace. Cost is always a huge one when it comes to SIEM. This is one of the biggest ones we hear about with legacy SIEM. By migrating data into Panther, we actually save customers anywhere from 25 to 50% off of their SIEM budget, really depending on the scale of the data that they're looking to ingest. And of course, the infrastructure. Trying to manage some of these SIEMs, you have hot, warm, cold, frozen buckets. You have to figure all that out. As you start to add more data, you have to continually re-architect it. By leveraging Snowflake on the back end as our security data lake, we don't have to mess with any of that. I almost feel spoiled. After working with some of the other vendors, I come in, I just throw data in, and I search it, and I don't have to worry about it, which is really nice. And then there's resources. Who's actually going to manage that infrastructure? A lot of times, people want an MSSP for their SIEM just to manage that data infrastructure. You have to have two full-time employees just to manage it and ensure that it's operating efficiently. So we are a cloud-native SIEM. We solve this. Again, we can do security operations at scale. Everything is incredibly elastic. Our Lambda architecture, again, we can scale automatically up and down. We also are able to leverage Snowflake. Again, there's basically unlimited data ingest we're able to bring in. Again, we have a full year of data retention. We've also pioneered the concept of detection as code. All of our detections are written in Python. So you have access to the entire Python library when you're writing your detection. It's not often that security teams get to be creative, right? So think about all the cool things that you can do with Python. We also then apply software development processes to that as well. So we can actually do version control. We can actually have a process, too, where maybe a junior analyst, before their detection gets pushed into production, it has to be approved. So we can leverage GitHub Actions to be able to do that. Someone puts a bad detection in that triggers a bunch of false positives. We can then go back and roll that code back very easily. And again, that's we have workshops around this. So if you're interested, let me know. So let you know how it kind of works. We're able to bring data from pretty much any source. We have real-time alerting where we actually parse, normalize, and then apply our detection rules. We store that data into our Snowflake as our back-end architecture. And we then trigger alerts. And we can send those alerts to anywhere. We can send it into Jira tickets. We can send it to another SIEM if you like, or you can send it to an automated process. So we really focus on speed. We focus on scale. And with this, we also have quite a bit of power and flexibility with how you're actually applying your detections and rules. We have a lot of customers. Again, a lot of our customers are really tech companies and like people that are cloud first. That's really where we really shine, particularly when you're dealing with high volume, high velocity log sources. So if you want to learn more, please stop by our booth for a demo. We're at 145. I'll be popping over there for about another hour or so. So if you want to talk to me, if you have any questions about anything I presented to you today, I hope you guys enjoy the show. And thank you for your time. I appreciate it.